Welcome to Zeitgeist Labs. This is Alex.
This is Brian.
And we are here with the fifth episode in our first collection, in which we are taking a deep dive into some of the artists and releases from Drive Thru Records. Brian, what is up tonight?
Not a whole lot. You know, we talked a lot off mic, but yeah. Aside from all of that off mic business, I'm doing pretty good.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm smoking tonight. You know, after going several podcasts in a row with, you know, without any weed in me, but we're breaking that streak tonight because it's been a rough one, but we're gonna make it out alive, I think.
So anyone that's listening, tweet at us if you like, because I can't tell when Brian's been smoking unless he tells me. So if there's anyone out there that's listening that can tell, I'd be interested to hear what their take is on how they can tell. See if there's any tells you have.
Episode 2, I think, is the other. No, episode 2 is the first one I did sober.
Was it? Okay.
Yeah, so episode 0 and 1, I'm high. And now on 5, I'm high. So yeah, listen to 2, 3, and 4 and see if you could tell a difference between 2, 3, and 4, and then 5.
Nice. So, okay. So since last time we talked, you got locked out of your house. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yeah. Ironically enough, I went to visit the weed man and he picked me up and I left my house without my keys.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to call the maintenance guy. I was outside in the cold for about a half hour, maybe 45 minutes. And just weed in my pocket and nothing else, you know, and my phone, which was dying. So
yeah. Did you have a coat at least, or?
Yeah, I just had my big hoodie. That's about it.
Cause what is it, like negative 20 degrees in Wisconsin right now?
No, dude, it's been like 30, like in 25, like pretty consistently.
That's not too bad.
Yeah. We just got snow after like weeks and weeks without it, last week. So,
okay.
Yeah, it's been pretty nice. So, and it's going to stay pretty nice, I think.
How early does it usually start snowing there?
Well, now that like global warming has been increasing each year, it's been pretty late, and later with each year, I think.
Yeah.
So,
it's the same here. When I was growing up, because Utah, we get a lot of snow, and when I was growing up, we would start getting snow sometimes as early as like the first half of October, but the last 10 years or so, we usually don't get anything until December now, and like the temperatures are nicer, which, yeah, it's nicer, but obviously, like you said, it's a sign of how we're fucking up the environment, basically.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, most people think it's bad, but as you all know, I'm a
pro climate change.
I not only do I think climate change is very, very real and a huge threat to our whole entire planet, I welcome it because I live in Wisconsin, where it's notoriously cold in the winter and I hate it and I have seasonal depression, so I welcome every hot sun that falls over Wisconsin in the winter.
So when you get a car, you'll just be constantly running it, even when you're not driving anywhere. It'll just be like out in your driveway.
Maybe you could buy a car to just sit out there
and idle it. Like, don't even drive it. Just sit out there and let it pollute the ozone.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to contribute to it directly. I just want to watch it happen.
Oh, okay.
I'm not like pro climate change in the sense where let's make it worse, like actively.
Okay, so you want to benefit from it, but you don't want to contribute to it.
I'm against stopping it from happening because I feel like I shouldn't say that. But I'm not like against stopping it, but I'm just like not as concerned as everyone else. But I get everyone else's concern. Like, I mean, I don't want California or Wodonga to be on fire.
No, definitely not.
I mean, if we could all have a happy warmth, if it could all just be one temperature at once, that'd be cool.
For sure.
I don't think it works like that.
Probably not. Okay, so let's see. I think we're recording this like 10 days before Christmas. Well, less than that. We've got 9 days till Christmas, but this won't be out till after Christmas. So if you're listening to this now when it comes out on Christmas, we gave all you pieces of shit a nice little present and put our first Patreon episode in front of the paywall. So check that out if you haven't. And if you like what you heard, you can always check us out at patreon.com/zglabpod. And you've got a few more days to sign up during the month of December, and that will bank you a sweet painting by the Fentuzler, as well as a holiday greeting, even though it's after the holiday now.
It'll just be a greeting.
It'll be a greeting, yep.
Yeah.
We recorded our one and only greeting so far the other night, and I think it's well worth the $3 that you'll have to pay for it, on top of the painting and the bonus episodes and all that. So check that out. We're recording way ahead of time, as I basically just said, so I have no idea what the response is to our last episode, but I've been getting some good interaction with some of you guys on Twitter, so keep that up. You can find us on Twitter at ZGLabPod. We have a small but loyal following so far, so thanks everyone who's out there engaging with us.
As of this recording, we hit 69 followers.
So close to the sex number.
True. Yeah, we hit that already.
All right. Anything else that we need to cover?
No. We were talking about my job earlier a little bit.
Yep. Today was your second day of training, right?
Yeah. My second day at work. My first day at work, my client, he's in fourth grade. He's a young guy, and so he's got like his little toy area, and he picked up a little Batman figurine and held it up to his face and said, "I'm Batman." That was like one of the first things he said to me when I met him. And in my head, I wanted to be like, "Oh, so you're a fascist, huh? Is that what you're saying?"
You're a fascist.
Are you familiar with the Batman is a fascist discourse that was on Twitter a couple years ago?
No, I'm not familiar with that.
Yeah, no, apparently Batman's a fascist because he beats up homeless people and mentally ill people. I guess that's what the big takeaway from Batman is now.
Is that Batman is a fascist?
Yeah, I don't know. But I wanted to tell my client that, but I would have got fired.
Well, God, if you go to YouTube and search Batman is a fascist, you certainly get a plethora of videos here about trying to answer that question.
I told you it's a real theory out there. I never really thought about it that way, but I don't know.
All right. Well,
yeah. I mean, it's Twitter. I mean, if someone believes it, if you can believe it, someone believes it.
Right, and it's out there. All right, well, Batman's a fascist. I don't think I think that's the end of the episode then, right?
Yeah, pretty much. I think
we've accomplished what we needed to this week.
Yep.
All right, we're here to talk about the release from the starting line, Say It Like You Mean It. Welcome back, Marsden Ash, the resident cover art aesthetics merch pundit. Marsden, how's it going tonight?
I'm doing good, guys. Glad to be back. Thank you again for having me on. How are you guys doing?
Doing well.
Doing pretty good.
Yeah, our fans demanded more of your content, so you have graciously agreed to come on and give us your input on some of these covers. So let's get into it. This week, we're talking about the Starting Lines album, Say It Like You Mean It. You can see my screen here?
Yep, okay. I can. Yeah.
All right, so... Yeah, just I guess lay it on me. What do you think about this cover?
So this one, I don't know why, but as soon as I looked at it for some reason, I very much like I looked at it and I was like, isn't this an All American Rejects cover? And I'm pretty sure that it's not. I looked at a couple of them and I don't think that they have any that look like this. But for some reason, looking at it, I was like, yeah, this. I don't know, maybe it's like a Mandela effect sort of thing happening in my brain. I'm like, if this exact same album cover just had their band name on it, I would be like, yeah, that's a thing that I've seen before. No big deal.
Okay.
The vibe wise, I mean, like it, I don't know. It smacks a little bit of, it gives me like Bring It On vibes. Maybe. Do either of you guys remember that movie?
Yeah.
Loki, yeah. Absolute hitter. That movie rules. It's, yes. I don't know why, but like, For movies of that era that are like very obviously targeted at teen girls, that movie slaps. Like it holds up and it is good.
It is good, yeah, for sure.
But yeah, this one really gives me kind of like Bring It On slumber party energy. Sonically though, I think that just because for whatever reason I look at it and I'm like, yeah, this is an All American Rejects cover. That I imagine it's gonna sound kind of like that, or maybe kind of like, you know, the Academy is like that sort of vibe.
I mean, I appreciate the analysis, but like, what is your actual opinion? To me, I look at this and I think this is just, it's just such a vanilla cover. It's like, it's boring. I can't deduce anything from it. I'm like, okay, there's a girl on a phone. I don't know. To me, it's like, it's nothing basically.
I think that that's one of the reasons that it maybe looks to me like an All American Rejects cover, is because I feel like I'm picking up on something in this kind of broad space of aesthetics of stuff that I know theoretically exists within the broader world of like punk and pop punk, just because I know that that's what those bands are considered, but that I would like never look at it and be like, that's the kind of music this is, you know?
Okay.
And I feel that way about All American Rejects aesthetics generally. Like their album art, the way that they dress, their music videos, like none of it, not that their music is exactly like the most punk music out there, but you know, it still exists within a certain kind of like 2000s emo pop punk kind of world. But like the aesthetics of it are always something that, like, I don't know, even as like a 12 or 13 year old at the height of like emo being a thing, there was still like a certain family of bands in which they certainly fit, that I was always like, I know that this is like tangentially related to something that I'm into, but I just don't understand how, like, I don't understand where it connects. And for me, this seems to like fall into that same space. I agree with your, when you say it looks kind of vanilla, I look at it and I'm like, there's just nothing about this that, other than like knowing that it's on a label that mostly puts out a certain kind of music, I look at this and I'm like, there are no like familiar touchstones to pick at aesthetically here. Gotcha. In terms of like, okay, what kind of music I dig. I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So, well, here is a clip of the single from this album. It's called The Best of Me.
Tell me what you thought about when you were gone and so alone. Worst is over, you can have the best of me. We got older, but we're still young. We never grew out of this feeling that we won't give up.
Yeah, this doesn't sound like, I don't know if it came through in my description, but this does not sound wildly off from what I was envisioning. It's kind of got that like that same sort of like bands that aren't so far removed from Dashboard Confessional, but that emo kids still like, kind of energy.
I think for this record label especially, it's pretty much, it's probably as close as they get to something like the All American Rejects, so I don't think we're far off at all. I think you nailed it. All right. Okay. Thanks, Marston.
Hey, yeah, of course. We'll see you guys next time.
All right. So Say It Like You Mean It by The Starting Line. Brian, I know after we recorded our last episode, you said you're maybe a little bit more excited to get to this one because this is a band and a album you're familiar with. Is that right?
Yep. So, yeah, very much so.
So what do you remember about this album then, if this is one that you kind of knew before we got into recording this?
Yeah, so my history with this album was like, I wasn't, like, this came out when I was in middle school, so I wasn't cool enough to have heard this whole album, but uh-huh. I always liked this band's singles, like, but yeah, I got into this album, like, way later when I had my, like, really big pop punk and, like, emo phase, when I was, like, 19 and, like really depressed for not the first time, but, like, just out of high school and going to community college, and, like, going to therapy and dealing with depression. And, like, after every therapy appointment, I would, like, drive past, like, a used record store on my way home.
Okay.
And, like, I would stop there and, like, stock up on, like, all the old, like drive-through bands, like, CDs and shit, and, like, all the 90s emo bands and stuff like that. Yeah. So this was, like, one of those albums I got. And this was, like, really big with me for, like, a year or two.
Yeah. So you enjoyed it at the time when you picked it up?
Oh, for sure, yeah. This was a big part of, like, my, like, pop punk and emo phase.
Yeah. So this is one thing I'm just noticing right now while I'm looking at the Wikipedia page. It came out in 2002, but the one and only single from it, which of course was The Best of Me, the big hit, wasn't released until a year later, in July of 2003.
Yeah, I think they they didn't push this band to be like mainstream until after this album must have blown up before the single did.
Yeah, maybe.
It must have pushed the single, or maybe that one popped off with like fans or something.
Yeah, and like we've talked
about. It's a banger, though. This is like, it's like easily the best song on the album, but like my big takeaway from this album was that like it didn't completely overshadow it. Like every song, like there's no skips on this album, I don't think.
I don't think so either, no.
Yeah, every song is like a hit, but like that is like the banger.
Yeah, oh, for sure. I mean, I've seen them live a couple times, mainly at Warped Tour. But the one time I saw them outside of that, that's, of course, the song they end with. And everyone's just in the crowd chanting, best of me, best of me. So, I mean, it's definitely the fan favorite. It's the big hit, which is, I mean, like you said, it's an amazing song.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if I'd want to, I don't know if they're still active and playing shows, but I don't know if I'd want to see, when I kept watching like live videos of this band, I was like, this band never should have got back together. They should have. This is like the quintessential like suburban angsty pop punk band. Like,
yeah,
like they should have like left that like in it. Like that should have just been a time capsule. They never revisited. You know. Like,
yeah, maybe. I mean, this is obviously their first full length. Did you get into it? Well, okay, so before this, they had With Hopes of Starting Over, which was an EP.
Yeah, I was going to listen to like all their old EPs before this one, because those were on Spotify too, and I ran out of time.
Did you ever get into any of their albums after Say It Like You Mean It?
I don't think so. I know like the big singles off of the second album, like the one where he's like, I'm going to tear your ass up like we just got married.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like that one, but I don't think I heard that whole album.
I don't really like that one, but their third and most recent one, which is still like over 10 years old at this point, I think, is probably my, I don't know. It's so hard because Say It Like You Mean It is like the quintessential like pop punk album. And it was, I mean, it's a great album. I think maybe it's been so long that I don't realize how, like you listen to it now, it just seems so cookie cutter, but I think they were helping kind of form the mold of what pop punk sounds like at that time. So now yeah, when I listen to it, I'm like, this is just generic, but it's like, well, this is where some of the generic started. This like people derived from this, right?
Yeah, I had that in my notes too, where like this album specifically, I think influenced a shit ton of like the pop leaning pop punk bands that would like become like really big, like All Time Low. I don't know if you're familiar with them.
Sure.
I feel like that starting line that was like big influence on them, even though they claim Blink as like their main influence, but they don't sound anything like them. But yeah, like all the, like the more poppier pop punk bands, like I think this was a huge influence on them, and unfortunately none of those bands are good, but like starting like kind of perfected that sound, I think, with this album.
Yeah, but what I respect about them is that they managed to I feel like keep their sound fresh but still good. So like the second album was decent, Based on a True Story. It's not my favorite, but it's definitely good. And then their final album from 2007, Direction, I think is a really solid album. And it's like nothing like Say It Like You Mean It. And I think it's all the better for that, because it just kind of gives, like, it kind of makes each era of this band distinct, which I enjoy, rather than just having the same album over and over again, the same exact sound over and over again. Sure.
So this is a big band for you, huh?
It is. Yeah, I mean, this is. So I think we've talked at length in a couple of the episodes about how, you know, I got into Drive-Thru and then started collecting the records. This is one I got before I ever started collecting anything, like after I heard them on the Drive-Thru comp, Welcome to the Family. I then went and picked up this record the next year when it came out, Say It Like You Mean It. And so like it's huge to me. I think this is as close to a perfect album as you can get at, in terms of like pop punk in this era. And what I really liked it at the time was I liked listening to music loud. I would listen to it, you know, in my room. I would listen to it when I was showering or whatever, but I was afraid that my parents would be upset if I was playing like swearing songs a lot. So like I would set up certain, like I had like this old CD player where you could like program, oh, I just want to listen to tracks, you know, 1, 2, 4, 7 or whatever. So sometimes I would have to like go through the whole thing of, for instance, say putting on Enema of the State and just the ones that don't have swears in it, right? But this was one that as a teenager that didn't want to upset his parents or, you know, whatever, this was a good one because the sound is great, but it's completely clean lyrically in terms of like there's no cussing or anything,
right? Yeah, this is a safe one.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's interesting because, I mean, like you said, like if you look at, for instance, All Time Low or bands like that, they point to Blink as an influence. And I don't know if that band specifically would also point to the starting line. But when I think of, obviously musically, there's a lot of parallels between this and Blink, but lyrically, not so much. And I don't just mean in the sense of, well, you know, Blink, you know, they swear more frequently and the starting line doesn't seem to really swear almost at all. But it just seems like these songs by the starting line, they're a lot more earnest, right? Like it's more emotional lyrics, right? Whereas Blink, they had those sometimes, but if it paid off or not, it never felt as genuine as some of the lyrics that that the starting line has.
Right. And like one of my notes was like, if Good Charlotte is like the Hot Topic of pop punk,
okay,
then this is like the Pac Sun.
Okay. Yeah, that's fair. Uh-huh.
Or like the Abercrombie maybe of pop punk.
Okay.
Like this is what gets played in like the dressing rooms or something. It's like beach pop punk almost.
Almost, yeah. But it's just like, I mean, looking through the tracks here, like Up and Go, Leaving, Best of Me, Good Night Sleep, all of these, they're almost all about some sort of, you know, attempted relationship or a lost relationship or some sort of like romantic yearning. And that's like, that seems to be the theme lyrically through all of the songs. Whereas if you look at like a band like Blink, they have some of those, but they have other songs that aren't about like their joke songs or their songs about like other teenage experiences, like, you know, pissed off at mom and dad or whatever. It seems like the starting line, at least on this album, kind of went all in on we're earnest and we want to sing about relationships that we want or are in or have lost or something like that.
Yeah, this band and Dashboard kind of went hand in hand for me when I was going through my 19-year-old emo phase.
Yeah.
That I mentioned before. Yeah, because it's all very earnest and very like relationship, like suburban angst oriented. And for that, sure. That was exactly what I was feeling when I was at 19.
Yeah, for sure. And
perhaps currently.
Yeah. okay, so I think we both kind of agreed that The Best of Me is the best song on the record. Though, I still think it's an amazing song. And, if I think about it objectively, that is the best one. Though maybe at this point for me, yeah. I'm a little over it. It's just a little overplayed for me.
Mm.
I assume you went back and listened to it in preparation for recording this. Is that still the one that jumps out to you as being the hot track on the album?
Yeah, but there's so many. I don't have the track listing in front of me, but Leaving is one. Up and Go was really good. The Drama Summer was really hilarious.
Hilarious.
It was so fucking, it's just him and the acoustic guitar just talking about some teenage romance that probably took place during the summer and was really dramatic.
Okay.
That's the name.
So I thought maybe we could, much like last episode, just maybe analyze one of the lyrics from this album. So let's just look at that one since you brought it up. Maybe hopefully this band is a little bit more popular.
Lyric segment.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh yeah, because we did that on the last episode with the.
Hey, man, Jesus Christ! Once again, there's no annotations. But okay, so for the Drama Summer, he says we could wait for the long. Oh, sorry, we could wait for the wind to blow, or give me a look so cold it gives me chills and ends the summer war. My eyes roll around and over and again, falling down dizzy with sunstroke. I'll be there. And I'll try to identify, try to look through the gray skies in your eyes. I'll pick up everything you left behind, cross your fingers and pray for winter. I'll be there, painting the town your favorite color. Guess I'll call or see you around. And then he just kind of repeats that, painting the town your favorite color. So, this is definitely a typical, like you said, angsty teenage song. As a man in his 30s now, I can't relate to anything that I'm reading here. This is not emotions you have at my age anyway.
Right.
But I think there's something
really charming about hearing it now, because it makes you nostalgic for that.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
It's things are a lot more simple back then.
Yeah, absolutely. And I can remember playing some of these songs and just being oh, this song is about me. A Good Night's Sleep is one that I really related to at the time. I think during one of my breakups, just this, the whole, because that one's just kind of about a breakup, obviously. And I still think it's, to me now, looking back on it now and just saying I'm kind of over The Best of Me, I think A Good Night's Sleep is probably my favorite track on the album at this point.
Oh yeah. That was a good one too. Yeah.
And it's different. It's kind of a break from the typical pop punk sound. It's a little bit more mid-tempo.
Yeah, it was more ballady. Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. I like how that was at the halfway point of the album too, right?
Yeah, track 5 out of 13, so a little bit before the halfway. Yeah,
I was gonna say that was a good mid-album track. It's a good plateau, I think, or a peak.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so it sounds like beyond this album, though, you didn't really explore them too much.
No.
Well, I definitely recommend checking out Direction from 2007. It's a great album.
Yeah, I'll give that one a shot. What's the vibe on that one? So you said it was not the same as this one at all.
Yeah, it's a lot more. It's not. I don't know how to describe it. Let's see if I can pull up. I'm trying to think what's the best one. So I think let's check out the song Island by The Starting Line from 2007 Direction.
I'll sport a
That was pretty good. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I really like it.
Noticeably more mature.
Definitely more mature, and like the bass comes through a lot better. Like I like the bass lines on this album, which I think plays to. I mean, Kenny, the lead singer, I believe, is also the bass player, so he really shines on this album.
He's the rare bassist vocalist.
Yes.
Him and the guy from Slayer, and I think the guy from Kiss.
Oh, God, Kiss. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, let's not do a whole collection about Kiss before you suggest
it. Agreed. No, I was going to suggest it. I love Kiss so much. And definitely my favorite part of the Olympics, having been here in Utah, is when Kiss performed at the closing ceremonies. That was just...
What?
Yeah, if you go back, the closing ceremonies, for some reason, Kiss is there. And
we got to watch that later on the pod.
Yeah, I bet it's probably... It's freaking NBC. Salt Lake City Olympics. Huh. Oh, Kiss, here we go. Kiss at the closing ceremony of the 2002 Olympics.
First of all, I didn't even know the Olympics were in Utah.
Yeah, 2002.
Oh. So naturally, they got Kiss to represent America.
Yeah, I guess they sort of represent Utah.
Yeah, when I think America, I think Utah, and I think
Kiss. And Kiss, yeah. I mean, there's nothing more American than Salt Lake City and Kiss.
Right.
So, yeah, that's right. They performed at the closing ceremonies here in my home state some 18 years ago. God only knows why.
Yeah. Wow.
Okay. See.
That was a nice little detour.
It was a nice detour. An awful reminder of something I tried to forget every day. Okay. Anything else to say about this album before we move into some live performances?
No, it's good and I like it.
Yeah. I think that's all that needs to be said. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Okay, so here they are playing Leaving. And this was uploaded in August of 2011.
Every song on this album is so fucking catchy, too.
Like, it's so good, yeah.
I'm not going to sing on the pod, but I really wanted to sing along with that opening part.
Right.
Before, like, the rest of the band kicked in. I don't know. Maybe it would be fun to see this band live now.
I think for sure. Like when I saw them, I thought it was great.
Yeah, but like I don't know. I was like really romanticizing this album a lot, and like wishing like it could just stay in that time period.
Yeah. All right, that's not like the greatest sound quality. I thought it was going to sound better because the video's a really nice looking.
Yeah, a very fancy intro with the live video.
Yeah.
Very deceitful.
Okay, here they are playing A Good Night's Sleep live at the TLA. December 29th, 2009. I think the TLA is in Philadelphia.
Yeah, the quality's not much better on this one either.
No, not tons. So that's the one question I would have, and I'm just gonna sound like a broken record, but did Drive Thru sign any bands that can't perform live?
Like, right, yeah. Like every single band we watch on here is so good.
Yeah.
Live. Like it's, I don't know what it is.
And I don't, maybe it's just because I'm used to, I mean, the one I can think of is obviously like Blink, and they suck live. And that's one of the bands I've seen probably the most. But maybe more bands are better playing live than I give them credit for.
Yeah.
Okay, here they're playing the Drama Summer, September of 2001. Oh, this is a really old one.
Yeah. Oh, that's really weird to watch, like, just him with the microphone and, like, yeah, it's weird seeing him not play bass.
Yeah, for sure. He's got his bleached hair.
Oh yeah, he's still got the bleached hair.
I mean, this is before, this is like almost a year before this album even came out. So this is, I mean, it literally looks like they're just playing like on a football field at a high school or something.
Right, I was wondering where they were, yeah. Like, yeah, it does look like they're like, like a football game or something. I was gonna say, like, they probably don't play this one live anymore.
I don't know.
This seems like, I have a feeling like, because like when I met when like it was hilarious, it's just because it's like so over dramatic and like suburban. And, you know, like,
yeah.
I have a feeling that, yeah, I have a feeling he would be embarrassed by this song.
Oh, there he's got his bass. I think the second half of this video they play Leaving. Let's take a look. God, this song is so good.
Yeah.
I mean, again, even back then, this sound really good. I don't know how this managed to be a good, like a well-recorded video. Like most of the videos from 2001 that are live sound like shit.
Right, this is like not bad at all.
Alright, well, I was definitely into that. That was really good. And I love finding like those old ones.
Yeah.
Okay, here's another live one of them doing A Good Night's Sleep from 2002 at the Backstage Pub. Let's see if we can get a better audio on this one.
Oh, nice. Yeah, this is like 2002, yeah. This is like when the album came out. This is like, pop punk.
Yeah, this is about a month before the album came out.
Yeah.
I had that Atticus shirt. It's the one with the, it's like in red writing on the front.
With the bird on it?
Or? Yeah, with the bird above Atticus. I had that one.
Yeah.
I think the guy, the guitar player to his right, oh look, they're all wearing Atticus shirts. Except the drummer, who's of course shirtless.
Yeah, as most drummers tend to be.
Yeah.
But yeah, they probably got sponsored at that point. That's like peak Atticus.
Yeah, May of 2002, for sure.
Yeah, that's when, yeah, oh yeah, that's when this whole, that whole pop punk look was at its peak, for sure.
Yeah, I just wonder, like, do they get sponsored, or are they just like, oh, we want to be like Mark and Tom? He still has it, yeah.
The Atticus shirt and the Puka Stone mask, this doesn't get more pop punk than that.
Classic look.
And the bleached hair. Like, come on.
Okay, all right, there was that one. I think that, let me make sure I found them. Oh, no, you sent me some live ones too, right? Oh,
yeah, I got one really early on, I think, and then like a much later Warped Tour video, I think.
Was there an
early on? Yeah, you've got like hella videos on here. I like how I said, yeah, I got on Tuesday, I got the time to research, and then I just sent you like two or three YouTube videos, yeah. And now I'm staring at like a seemingly endless playlist of starting line content.
Right.
I was just like, I was like patting myself on the back, like, oh yeah, I did research this week.
You did some.
Good for me.
Okay, so this is them playing it. Probably The Best of Me, if I had to guess. We're waiting for the video load. It doesn't say, it just says the starting line from October of 2002.
Yeah, Hey 56 uploaded a lot of dry food bone.
Oh, really?
From this 2000, yeah, the early 2000s. I think there's some, maybe there's some RX standard ones. I'm just remembering now.
Oh, this must be a full set. This is like 43 minutes long.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it is. Yeah, all Hey 56 is full sets.
Oh, are they?
Yeah. Yeah, this is an awesome YouTuber. He mostly does hardcore, though.
Yeah. Man, Lowell's got the punk jumps going.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I watched this one, and then I watched the Redfield one. Anyway, yeah, because the guitar player's hairline is completely gone. It's like...
I wish it had it broken up so we could go to specific songs.
Oh, yeah. That's like the one downside. I mean, usually some hero will do it in common.
Yeah. That's really cool. I'm going to have to go and watch that. Okay. The other one you sent me was them playing it live at Warped 2019 in New Jersey. I believe they're from New Jersey.
Yeah,
so this must have been the final Warped tour.
The last one was in New Jersey too, the Hey 5-6 one.
Yeah.
I love you, Kevin Limer. Thank you for not putting us on at noon. I love you so much. This is so beautiful.
He says he loves Kevin Limer.
That's problematic.
Yeah. I was gonna say.
The live videos, like the audio is good enough that I can hear everyone singing next to this phone or whoever's recording it bothers me.
Right, yeah, it's not the best.
Okay, should we get into some covers?
Let's get into some covers. Did I send you a cover?
You did, yep. Yeah, this one by Paper Rockets.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
So we can go ahead and start with that one. All right, this is...
I can't remember if this is good or bad.
Okay.
I don't know why I sent it to you.
So it's a cover of The Best of Me by a band called Paper Rockets. And it was uploaded in July of 2016. Are they? Okay. Let's check it out here. Tell me what you thought about when you were gone. That's a super nasally voice.
Oh, yeah. This one is bad.
It's bad? Okay.
Yeah. I remember that.
I like how it's shot like it's like someone's filming them on a TV or something.
Right. Yeah, this is a really elaborate video for a cover song.
It is, Jesus.
Which isn't even like... It sounds soulless, you know? It's like a very soulless cover.
Yeah. It doesn't have any bite to it. It
really doesn't. All the, like, that, I think that's why I kind of feel like it's pretty bad. It's like... competent, but like, what's the point, you know? All the magic sucked out of it somehow.
Yeah. I mean, they're playing all the right notes and all the right parts, but it still managed to sound like shit.
Yeah, I don't want to mosh to it.
No. Okay, so first one that I've got here is a piano cover by a user called, well, I don't know who the user was, but it says it's by Late Night Habit.
Late Night Habit.
Yep. Oh, and that's
I got
who uploaded
late night
it.
Habit.
Right, and this is from 2011. Tell me what you thought about when you were gone and so alone. Okay, I'm not seeing how this is a piano cover.
Yeah, I was gonna say I don't see it or hear piano. God, it makes me very uncomfortable.
Okay, here we go.
Oh, that's cool.
That's a nice piano part, yeah.
Yeah, it's a nice piano.
Yeah, the stand-up pianos, they're pretty cool. Oh, he's snapping. This is a weird video. It's like showing them recording everything. Is he in a furniture store?
I was going to say, this sounds like commercial music. Or like, yeah. Yeah, this sounds like it would be played in the waiting room somewhere.
Yeah. All right, that was something. Okay, so here's another. This one's another piano cover. I think I actually watched part of this one. This one actually was a piano cover. Let's see. This is uploaded September of 2013 by Piano Keys 83. I like that the video is just a still picture of a piano. I never understood why anyone does this.
Right.
Like, what is the benefit of doing this? And it says 2,400 views in 7 years.
I can't even hear it.
Okay. All right. How do we feel about ukulele covers?
Oh, no.
So here it is. Of course, pretty much every cover I found is of Best of Me, because that's the only song anyone seems to care about. So here's a ukulele cover of The Best of Me by Drive Through. Oh, my God.
By what?
Drive Through.
Oh.
It's like a mix of Drive Through and uke.
Ew. So tell me what you thought about. Yeah, these ukulele people, they always have some sort of ukulele pun in their name.
Yeah.
But there's a real nasty one called Uke Hunt.
Oh, great.
Yeah, I think they put out music on Fat Records. Fat Mike's label.
Can't believe that a record label would sign a uke artist.
Well, I mean, Fat Mike would, so. And that's exactly what he did, so. I can believe it. But you can't believe it.
No. All right, well, that's about enough of that.
Yeah, I don't really need white people playing ukuleles in front of me.
Okay, maybe we cleanse the palate. I didn't listen to this one, but it says, starting line, Best of Me, Danarchy Pop Punk times Hip Hop Remix / DJ Tool.
That could cleanse the palate, maybe. I don't know. That was a lot of words.
Make it worse, yeah.
Yeah, that's hard to tell. That was a lot of words. Ooh. Okay. This is potentially palate cleansing.
Yeah, had a good start. See what it does once this intro's over.
Oh, I was expecting it to go full dubstep. I mean, I guess it's still time.
Yeah.
This is like basically like the original song, but with more like aggressive electronic drum.
It sounds like it. And some weird like little bass, electronic bass part.
Yeah.
And no singing? Maybe singing will come in?
Let's skip. I don't think so. Oh, maybe. The weird remix. Yeah, I wouldn't say it's necessarily palate cleansing.
Yeah. Weird. No, it was better. I mean, it could have been a lot worse, but it wasn't what I was expecting.
Right? Yeah. It was like, what did it say? Like pop punk and hip hop, or something. Yeah,
pop punk times hip hop remix.
Yeah, I didn't hear any hip hop in there.
I think maybe this person just thinks anything electronic makes it.
Yeah, if you got hip-hop? Like 808 or something, I guess. I
yeah. Know. Okay, here's another cover of course, Best of Me. This one is from 2007, uploaded by Armin Geddon.
I like this already.
Okay, it's a fake cover. He's playing a broom. So he's just like lip syncing in. I mean, it's not air guitar because he's holding a broom.
Upside down.
The camera. What's going on?
They're just rocking out. Dudes rocking out. One's shirtless, one's playing a broom. I don't know where they are, but this is my favorite cover so far.
I just want to see what they keep doing. Like.
Consider the palette cleansed. Yeah, now the video is sideways.
Jesus. Oh, what the hell?
Oh, geez. And then a third face just popped out of the corner.
He's playing like a pillow or something.
Yeah.
Like a body pillow. And none of those guys are wearing shirts. This is...
No.
I wonder if they have any idea that 13 years later that this video has... like 6,000 views, or do they just like and upload it and never think podcast. About it again? Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Can we get these guys in the pod?
Okay. All right. Next, I don't know. This video claims it's Dave Melillo covering it, who is another drive-through artist that we talked to Marsden about a couple weeks back.
Oh, yeah.
So this is him covering The Best of Me, November of 2009. So one thing I will say about not just the starting line, but so far pretty much every band we've gone through is pretty much every cover is just an acoustic cover. No one's doing anything original with any of these songs.
No, not, aside from the last few.
Yeah, I mean, Hello Goodbye had like a couple a cappella ones, and then, we had that hip-hop remix of this.
I don't get why these are all just acoustics, but I don't know. I think maybe pop punk and emo is just, you know, a lot. The songs are just really easy to cover because they're not like very complex in the way they're written, you know, because it's just all essentially pop music.
Okay, let's see if Leaving sounds any better acoustics. This is Leaving. By Action Adventure, uploaded February 12th, 2019.
Oh, I know this band.
You know this band?
This band's awesome. Yeah. Yeah, I found them on TikTok of all places.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, because they're a pop punk band, like just very like straightforward pop punk, but
okay.
Like, They're the band is predominantly people of color, as you can see, and the song that's like, it's like, where it's like they have a song about how like, would you listen if we looked any different, you know, like kind of it's like that's like the hook of the one song I heard, but yeah, it's really cool. It's like you don't expect that because like people think pop punk's like a white, like predominantly white genre, but like,
yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So they're kind of changing that, which is cool. I mean, you're seeing a lot more of that now, actually.
Yeah. And that was really good. I mean, I don't know, maybe Leaving is the best song on this album. I don't know if it's possible to make that a bad song.
Yeah.
Okay. So now we've got three very white, middle-aged men covering Best of Me, of course. This is a band called Search and Rescue from July of just last year. So yeah, they were probably young when this song came out.
All right. Hi guys, this is Nick, Chris, and Brian. We're from Search and Rescue.
Okay. Blah blah blah.
I can't even hear it. Oh, there we go. I don't know why this song needs two acoustic guitars, though.
I don't know either. I mean, they're doing fine. I mean, I swear to God, I'm this close to just banning the covers section of this podcast if we just keep getting these shitty acoustic covers of everything.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, let's try this. We got Best of Me Techno.
Oh, sweet.
Well, hopefully it's actually technico. Okay, this is from Sheldon Nguyen. I'm probably pronouncing that wrong. I always pronounce that last name wrong whenever I see it. From September of 2008. Tell me what you thought about when you
were gone and oh, this is sick. Alone. The worst is
over. You can have the best of this is awesome. We got
older, but is it awesome or is it just cool because it's not an acoustic guitar cover?
It's a good question. I don't know. Let's see what happens when more music comes in.
Okay, yeah, this is pretty sick. Who are the people on, like, the video, though? Is that this techno band, or...?
I mean, I assume it's this... Oh. Someone named Vishal and Sheldon, I guess.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah, the dude on the right has a very 2008 haircut. That's what this is uploading, right?
Yeah.
2008.
Yeah.
Yeah, he looks like he's from 2008. Yeah,
just sounds like right. It's like if Hello Goodbye did the song.
Kinda, yeah. Like early Hello Goodbye.
I'm trying to see if there's anything else that even looks like it's worth going through.
Yeah, I was gonna say you got like a lot of videos on here.
We've got some that aren't acoustic, so let's give these a couple a try here. Sorry, my cats are making more fun noises behind me.
Stuck in the closet again, or
I don't know what the hell's going on. I hate my cats. Okay, this is a cover of Drama Summer.
Oh, sweet.
From Aaron Pearson. What is that? Is that a dog in the background?
Yeah, like they're playing like on a porch.
Yeah, they're on a porch. It's two guys and a girl.
Two dudes and some little girl.
Yeah. We can wait for the wind to blow. Forgive me, a look so cold. Give me chills.
Love those harms.
Yeah. If you're gonna do it acoustic, you might as well at least nail the harmonies like that.
Right, yeah, like the beatboxes trip.
I wonder what they're gonna do. They've got like this. They've got a bass pedal hooked up to something here. Skip ahead a little bit. It's gonna use that damn bass pedal?
Yeah, what is that even for?
Oh, he's stepping too close to it now. Get so cold to see you around, yeah. Get so cold to see you around. You see, if you're gonna do an acoustic cover, that's what it should sound like, essentially. Like, yeah. There should be harmonies, there should be, like... Don't just do it because you can do it. Do something original with it, I guess.
Right. I don't want to see some dork in their dorm room just playing it by the end of their webcam, you know? Right.
Exactly.
You know, at least go somewhere like on a porch or play somewhere cool.
Okay, this one interested me because in the thumbnail we see someone with like a bongo drum.
Oh.
And this... is Up and Go, which I don't know if we've seen this one get covered yet.
No, we haven't.
This is Maybe Next Time, Am I?
Hello. This is Up and Go by The Starting Line.
Oh, he's got a beanie.
One, two, three, four.
Yeah, he's got the ill-fitting green beanie. Cool.
Let's see, this is January of 2013. was not expecting the bongo to be the singer.
Yeah.
I mean, so his voice isn't great, but it's unique. I kind of like it.
Yeah, so if he's singing, that means he's the better singer, which I don't want to know what the other guy sounds like, man.
Oh, they try to harm.
Oh. Yeah, I think we're starting to reverse our take on YouTube. Like, just two videos ago, you're like, yeah, I don't know if I want to do the cover section anymore. Now, start redeeming themselves.
Yeah, no, that's, I mean, I like that. And the harmony actually wasn't that bad. I just think that one guy who wasn't the main singer, he sounds like he's got the high part. So maybe he's just not a voice built for melody. I don't know. All right, I think that was worth it. All right, the last one that we're going to do is a band called No Reception, and they are doing the song Leaving.
And it looks like Reception.
Reception. It looks like it's a full band cover. So let's see if they do it justice.
No Reception.
From October of 2013. Come on. Okay, so it sounds like they're playing.
No one heard the starting line. Oh man, he sounds awful.
He sounds bad.
Yeah. This is like some high school band.
It looks like it. Maybe a little bit older. This guy's rocking a nice beard. Sounds okay. They just need a different singer.
Yeah, for a high school band, not bad.
Yeah, it looks like this was 7 years ago in Greensboro, North Carolina.
Oh, it is.
One comment 3 years ago that says, yeah, voice crack at last. All right, that's all I've got. So, final thoughts.
That's all we got. Wow.
That's it.
This one flew by.
Well, do you still like it? Did these covers ruin it?
No, the covers didn't ruin it. It was a bit of a roller coaster, though.
Yeah. No, I like it. I still think it's probably one of my all-time favorite albums. Covered it. I'm glad that we're here doing this one. And I think I can't decide whether or not to promote the supposed guest because it's always come back to bite me in the ass every time I've done that. But hopefully we're going to have Makebelief join us to talk about the Starting Line and this record. And I think he's actually like a big-time Starting Line fan, so maybe he can enlighten us on some of these things that we're not too sure of. So stick around for that. Welcome to the Zeitgeist Lab, Skylar, a.k.a. Makebelief. Skylar, how are you doing tonight?
I'm doing great. How are you guys doing?
Doing really well.
Doing good.
So what's going on tonight? What's happening in your world?
Well, it's cold here. I'm also in the Midwest. I know Brian's up in Wisconsin, and I'm here in Iowa now, my native state. And
you're in Iowa.
I'm in Iowa, yep. The snow's just about gone.
In the Midwest.
It's down there. It's down at the bottom of
the maybe not the worst. I have some bad connections to Iowa personally. So.
Oh, okay. Maybe we can discuss that at some time. I'd love to hear about that.
Yeah.
Nebraska's not great. I gotta say
oh,
that.
Oh yeah, fuck Nebraska.
Yeah, that's a bad one too.
Mm-hmm. Especially when you're driving through it.
Both Nebraska. So I've got this goal. I don't know if either of you have ever heard of geocaching. I really don't want to get into it at all at this point because I feel like it makes me a total nerd. But I've got this goal to find.
Shit.
Oh fuck yeah! But I've got this goal to find a geocache in all 50 states. So for both Nebraska and Iowa, I was at my sister-in-law's wedding in Wyoming, and I was like, "Oh, Nebraska! We're like an hour from the border." So I literally drove to the Nebraska border, found a geocache right on the border, and then left. And then with Iowa, in 2016, I drove from Salt Lake to Kansas City or Lawrence, Kansas, 16 straight hours to see the Jack's Mannequin Everything in Transit 10-year reunion tour. Wow. And we passed right through Iowa and we crossed over this bridge. Welcome to Iowa. Found the geocache, left and said, fuck this. I'm never coming back to Iowa. Like, no offense, Skylar, but like Iowa and Nebraska, just two states. I have no interest in really getting to know too much.
That's fair. You have to really want it to be able to find the gold in these here hills. Otherwise, it is not all that pleasing to look at. I know that.
Nice. Okay.
Before we get into the band, I do have a little surprise for you guys I want to do on mic here, yeah. If I may.
Fuck yeah, yeah.
So I did go out and pick up a McRib.
Oh, I knew it.
Yes.
I knew it.
Yeah, it's a McRib.
Have you had a McRib before?
I think I've had one in my life, and it's probably been about at least 15 years.
Are you going to eat it right now?
I'm going to at least try it, I think, would be for the best.
Okay, so anyone who's listening... Anyone who's listening, we're recording this video. It's going to be up on our YouTube so everyone can see Skylar eat a McRib and give us a full reaction video to the McRib.
Wow. I did not know that the video component was included. But
I hope your camera ready. Yeah.
I'll do my best YouTube face. I've been thinking about this all day and thinking that it might have been a bad idea because I don't really want to eat it now. But
it's a bad idea, here it is. I promise you. But okay, yes. Yes. Pickles or no pickles?
So it's got pickles on it. It's the full decker, which is the rib, quote unquote. The onions, the bun, and then some pickles in there as well. Okay. We'll have at least one bite of this and we'll see
about it. Okay.
Here we go.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. It's not bad. Yeah.
All right. I mean, the pod is over. I don't have to do anything with the pod ever again. Like, sorry, Brian, this was it. This was the culmination of what I wanted to do.
Have someone eat a McRib live on air.
Exactly.
That was our whole goal. That's the awesome. Time.
Thank you. You're a true head of our podcast. Thank you for the McRib shout out.
It's I don't know if I'll get another one this year, but it's worth it to go out if you don't remember if it's good or not.
I had never had one until last week, so.
Wow. You were talking it up pretty big before then, right?
I know,
Brian.
No, that was me.
That was him.
I just love the idea of the McRib. I love this, like, the scarcity component that they put into it. Like, oh, McRib is back. Like, okay, so I'll tell you this right now. This is so embarrassing. Like, in high school, I was part of a rap group, and I always wanted to try to
fit. What?
Yeah. I always wanted to try to fit in the lyric. I wanted to try to fit in the lyric, bitch, McRib is back, but I couldn't. I never got it in there anyway. But like, I've always been obsessed with the idea of the McRib is back.
It's like guess who's back?
Yeah.
Katie's back.
Oh, yeah. That's McRib is okay. Back. Yeah. You should have been there. I think you could have helped me break it. That was, yeah.
Wow.
That's incredible. A major bomb. That's another bombshell from Alex.
I'm full of them, I promise too. You.
He contains multitudes.
I do, yeah. Okay, so...
What are we doing? Yeah.
We're trying to do a podcast. I don't know if it's going to be successful or not at all.
I may have derailed it from the start. I'm sorry.
That's fine. That's the whole idea. You know, props to Marsden. He was a great guest, but way too on topic. Like, I prefer something a little more unhinged. Okay, so let's start kind of big picture.
drive-through records, what does that mean to you? Anything? Are you someone that follows record labels, or?
I've done a couple record labels in my time, in terms of like following their output and stuff. I would say the biggest one for me was Anticon Records, if y'all know that. It's like sort of nerd rap, psychedelic rap from the early 2000s, the first decade of the 2000s, and it's cool stuff. And I was in a rap group as well because of my attention to that. But Drive Through was a name that I knew growing up because that was adjacent to or some of the bands I was listening to, but I didn't really get what labels did at the time, and so I didn't pay attention to the output. I just happened to encounter a handful of the bands that they were putting out. Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, thus far, we've recorded a few guest spots. They've been kind of solicited on our end, like, hey, we want to talk to this person about this. And super excited to talk to you, but you kind of were the one that threw out, I want to talk about the starting line.
Yeah.
It sounds like maybe part of it was, well, you know, we're talking about drive-through and that's the only thing you know, but is there a bigger reason why you want to talk about the starting line? Does it mean something more to you than just, oh, I have some people that I know doing a podcast and this is a mm-hmm. chance to be able to talk to them?
I mean, it definitely came from a place of like, oh, I want to participate and you know, that might be fun. But then the starting line is, I would say the other big band from Drive Thru for me was Newfound Glory for mm-hmm. sure. But then I felt it might be too egotistical to say I want to be on the Newfound Glory episode because that seems like the crown jewel sort of episode.
Sure. Fair enough.
Would be my guess. But yeah, I love the starting line. The starting line is like one of those bands, the few bands from when I was young, and that I think Say It Like You Mean It came out when I was 12 and I had it that year. And that's one of the few bands from that time that I still enjoy, that I've like kept listening to from that time. Everything else I've kind of outgrown and felt too cool for, something like that, but I still like their music. So
how did you find the starting line then? It's like, because I found them through kind of this obsession with Drive Through Records. If you didn't have that, like, what was your first exposure to this band?
I think in seventh grade I was I had a little girlfriend, you know, your junior high girlfriend sort of vibe. And she was really into that type of music as well. And she gave me Sticks and Stones by Newfound Glory. And then I think I was also watching a lot of MTV2 at the time, and music videos were how I learned about bands. And so I'm guessing I saw the Best of Me video and I loved it and wanted to like know that band. So I'm pretty sure I bought it. I remember, I don't think she gave that one to me. I think I went out and copped that record for myself.
So do you have like a visceral memory of the first time you heard that, or the feelings around that, or like what? Because for me, I found Drive Thru Records through, you know, a number of channels. But my first real introduction was with the Welcome to the Family compilation, the starting lines on that. I was like, oh, this seems like maybe the most accessible type of music on here, aside from Newfound Glory.
Yeah.
And
what song? Do you remember what song was on there? Which starting line song?
You know what? Actually, I think it might have been, and this is still to this day my favorite starting line song. I think it might have been Greg's Last Day.
Mm-hmm.
But let me check.
A song here that I just learned like yesterday. I've listened to their whole discography in the past 24 hours, so I am fully saturated with.
And you hadn't heard of that song before this?
I had seen it like on, you know, track listings or whatever, but I didn't have their early EP and. Maybe I'd heard it once or twice, but
yeah, it actually looks like the song was Leaving. So I don't know how I came to Greg's Last Day, but it was around the same time because they had like a 3-song sampler that was like a predecessor to Say It Like You Mean It, as well as that EP. I think it's called With Hopes of Starting Over.
Yep.
And Greg's Last Day is definitely on one of those, and maybe that's where I found it. So that's like my favorite starting line song. But yeah, I guess it was Leaving, which is, you know, a phenomenal song. I thought, I definitely want to go pick this up. So I got Say It Like You Mean It, and like from the moment I first heard it, I was like, oh fuck, this is so good, because like the bands that kind of helped me start get into this this type of genre, like Blink-182, I love those bands, but they were, you know, they had that jokey element to them, which I appreciate. I like that. But 2001, 14-year-old, hormones raging, all these feelings about like different girls and wanting this idea of like a relationship or something. Everything on Say It Like You Mean It spoke right to that, because it's just so earnest and genuine and like longing. I'm like I related to every song on this album.
Yeah, same. I think it was like I would have been 12, and I think at that time in my life I was very strictly keeping a journal, but it was, you know, only just the very I think I still have it. I kind of meant to grab it and pull a passage to
that would have been sick.
That would have been,
you know,
awesome.
It's all just like the not really understanding anything, but feeling like I have these grasps on these deep feelings and things.
Yep.
Like that. And that's kind of what this music sounds like. It's like the epitomization of really young, like, this is the biggest problem in the world. Is this, you know, this girl that I'm crushing on,
like,
or whatever.
You're like the main character in your story, and no one else exists. Kind of thing.
Yeah. Saddest Girl Story. That's one of the songs right on.
Right.
Exactly.
Well, and I think I mentioned this in the main episode, but the other appeal for me was like, I'm a big music listener. Like, I like to listen to it out loud. At this age, it was something that I would have been listening to, like, as I got ready for school in the morning. I had like this boom box in my bathroom.
Yep.
And so like, I would love to play things like Take Off Your Pants and Jacket or Enema, but I would have to program the disc in a certain way so I didn't have swearing songs for my parents to hear at like 6 a.m, right? And I think they knew I was listening to those sorts of things, but they didn't want to hear it out loud. Like, that's why we got you headphones. But I could put on this album and just play it as loud as I wanted, because there's nothing unparent friendly on this CD at all.
Yeah. At this time in my life, I was not allowed to buy Blink-182 CDs because of the parental advisory. So this one made it through the criteria, I guess.
Okay. So you mentioned let's start here. You mentioned the video for The Best of Me, which I've probably seen maybe once or twice at the time. I rewatched it again recently. Yep. Someone on Twitter, well, specifically David Park on Twitter, mentioned at the time he didn't care for it because he thought it was a ripoff of the music video for There Is by Boxcar Racer. I watched both of them.
Very similar.
Yeah, I can see maybe why he thought that. To be honest, even now, I don't really like either of the videos. What do you think about this video for The Best of Me?
I like the video. I just watched it like 5 minutes ago, and I do like it because I think that they look super young, and like, you know, they look like they've gone through wardrobe to look just so. Their hair is done, and
the necklace, kind of like the puka shell necklace.
Super tight,
iconic. Shirties.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like his hair is like very shiny. And I, at that time, all I wanted to do was like be a music video rock star. And so it was so cool. Anytime I heard music that I liked and the people looked cool. I think I was young enough that it worked on me. And I like the There Is video too. It's very, very just kind of digging through those sort of shallow emotions again, but doing a really good job of it. And it that
I've never seen
on
that
me.
One.
It's very similar.
It's very similar, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they're playing like on a front lawn. Yeah.
Yeah, right in front of someone's house. Yeah. Okay, that's good. So you mentioned something as well that in the last few days, at least, you've listened to the whole discography.
Yeah.
It starts as early as like maybe 2000, 2001. Assuming that you, we'll skip the live album that came out kind of afterwards.
I did do the live album.
Yep. But let's just say from the hopes of starting over up through Direction, which was 2008, 2009, I think. 2007. Okay, perfect.
I think it was 7. Yeah.
So, what is your take on the discography as a whole and the evolution of their sound? And do you like the whole thing through? Were there lulls? Were there more highs? What do you think?
I mean, I know we spoke in the DMs when I reached out to you on Twitter to offer up my services, and we disagree on the album based on a true story.
It's no good.
You said it was there. I need to preface this. I do not want to get into a fight about this band.
I like it a lot.
Yeah. Based on a true story, you like it, Brian?
Yeah, it's two against one. Sorry, Ali.
Have either of you, speaking of that album, have either of you heard the bonus track, the Japanese bonus track, Nights and Weekends?
No.
I don't believe so, no.
For whatever reason, the version that I had, I think I burned it from a friend. It just had that one on there, and I think it's one of the best, if not the best song on there. It kind of was a defining song for me, so when I went to Spotify to listen through, I was like, oh, it doesn't have that song, which kind of saves the end, because I do think it kind of gets sleepy at the end with Cut Printed, I think is the last song. But
should we take a listen?
Yeah, put Nights and Weekends on. It rocks. Gotta get to the chorus. Jump forward a little bit. There's a really good part a little bit later. Oh, here it comes. This is the stuff.
I liked that. I was into that.
Yeah, it's cool. But so the discography, I mean, the early stuff is nice. I think that Say It Like You Mean It is definitely the pith. Like, they're really at their peak, and that's where they really shined, with that real young attitude and kind of vibe to them. I think that there's some really good stuff on Based on a True Story. There are some snoozers on there for sure. Mm-hmm. And then Direction. If you think Based on a True Story is their worst album, you must think that Direction has some merit to it, is my...
No, I love Direction. Direction is incredible. So my issue with Based on a True Story, and like in retrospect, what I think happened, if I had to guess, because there are some decent songs on Based on a True Story, and all we just listened to was really good, especially that chorus, like the kind of the dual vocals at once, I thought was really good.
Yeah.
But if I had to guess, so you probably don't know, like you said, you don't know a lot about Drive Thru Records, but the way that some of these bands were able to get so famous was Drive Thru had a deal with MCA. And so MCA was helping put out, like, distribute all these records, kind of funding a lot of this. But they had a caveat that said, hey, if Drive Thru has a band that we think could be something big, we get to take them. They're no longer a Drive Thru band. They're an MCA band. And this happened with Something Corporate, Finch, and The Starting Line. And so while The Starting Line is a Drive Thru, or sorry, while Say It Like You Mean It is a Drive Thru release, Based on a True Story is not. So my theory is that the record label, the big record label, MCA, was like, yeah, we just need you to make Say It Like You Mean It again. And I don't think they were necessarily interested in that. So I feel like it was maybe a half-hearted effort to appease the record label that kind of fell short in a lot of spots, maybe.
Yeah, I kind of got that vibe as well. Like, it's, you can tell they want to change direction, but then, like, even lyrically they're pretty explicit about, you know, people wanting them to stay the same, remain the same shape. The inspired by the dollar sign, I think, is all about that. I read on the Wikipedia that the label really wanted them to make it more like a Catalyst by Newfound Glory, and I listened to them back to back today, and it is just like shocking, especially in the guitar work and kind of it's, you know, to use the word angular, it's like more angular okay. punk. They're both kind of trying to be a little bit heavier, but not too heavy.
Does it have a lot of weird like synthy parts like the new like Catalyst does?
No, Catalyst doesn't hold up as well as Based on True Story does for me.
Really?
There are some good songs up front, but they both are kind of top heavy, I would say.
Okay.
Kind of fall asleep towards the end for me. Anyway.
Yeah. Are we talking about Catalyst later, Alex?
We are, but I'm super interested in what you're saying about Catalyst, because for me, Catalyst is like the, and I know that I'm going to get raked over the coals for this, but for me, Catalyst is like the pinnacle of newfound glory. Like, you've got like the old school people that love like Nothing Gold Can Stay, like fuck that record. I mean, I loved, you know, the from the Screen to Your Stereo EP, the self-titled was really, really good. And like nostalgia wise, I love that one. Sticks and Stones is another one I just never really cared for, though I've gotten more into it in recent years. But Catalyst is definitely like, that is where I want to be all the time.
Mm-hmm. There are some hits, but Ryan, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, it's got hits. Sorry, I just put a bunch of chips in my mouth. Go ahead. I was like,
I just listened to Sticks and Stones last night, and it is like, for me, it's wall-to-wall hits. Like, I feel like there's not a track that misses on Sticks and Stones.
I hate the song Something You Call Personality. I think that song fucking sucks.
Oh, that one rules. Wow.
No, and I like even the fact that Mark Hoppus plays bass on it does not save it for me. Like, he does, yeah. Wow. Mm-hmm.
I'd like to think what I have is real.
It's like good. That was the one I always skipped when I got that one.
It's got the gang, but that's like their most hardcore song.
Yes.
It's got the gang vocals and shit. Oh man, awesome.
What's the song where the Why'd You Have to Go? That has that scream, the one like,
whoa! Oh yeah, that is really good. Is that I don't know. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Let me say these things about you after all that we've been through. It has both of these bands, Starting Line and Newfound Glory, do the thing where the song titles have no relation to the lyrics.
It looks like it's called Singled Out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever, yeah. But no, like over the years, I've definitely come to appreciate that one more. And I think now the only song I would skip is still Something You Call Personality. But for me, I really love Catalyst. I think they do some really interesting things in there. I was actually messaging intern of the pod, Randy from Finch, the other day, and like because he wanted to know what my all-time favorite drive-through songs were, and for me, Doubtful by Newfound Glory from Catalyst is right up there because it's got like the church choir type vocals in the background, and like I love that one front to back. So to me, that's
and the,
like,
the riff is great on that song.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And I know we're talking about kind of both of these bands,
we're talking about whatever.
Yeah, it's, I think they both,
we'll just
you know,
copy and paste this interview on the Newfound Glory episode too.
That's right. Sample it in there.
Sorry to whoever is guesting on that one already.
I feel like you guys should get a blue check for that one. You're gonna
get a blue
check on there. Yeah.
Yeah.
But they both bands have like the thing which was great at the time of having a person who's really solid on guitar and then one guy who's actually like pretty good at guitar and coming up with sweet lead lines. This is a problem that I have with Direction, actually, is I thought that the guitar work was not holding a candle to the earlier guitar work of Starting Line.
I think that's fair, but I like that they kind of reinvented their sound. It's a little like parts of it are a little bit more heavy. Parts of it are maybe a little bit more melodic. I think it was the right step, because if they had just made even another Say It Like You Mean It or another Based on a True Story, it would be boring and stale. But I think they did something that was fresh and that I was actually excited about when it came out.
Mm-hmm. I do think that we listened to it last night. I'm going to hold back from a lot of my negative criticisms to say that the first four songs I think are good. I think they're really good. 21 in particular is one of the best Starting Line songs ever, I think.
Yeah.
That song just rocks. And Are You Alone is very good. Island is obviously great. I think that the song Direction is good if you cut out the heavy bit.
See, the heavy bit's the part that I really like. I like the whole song, but I think that heavy bit is what I actually like about it.
It was on the live album.
Okay.
All that stuff, all my opinions go out the window because all the kids are singing, and it's like that's where it's really shines, right? Where like the energy of everybody singing it together is super cool.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm kind of still exploring this newfound glory thing. I think that's interesting if what you read is true, that the label wanted to sound like Catalyst, because I mean they're both punk bands, they're both from Drive Thru, but to me, I don't necessarily to me that's where the similarities stop. Like Newfound Glory was more of what I guess you'd call easy core, and Starting Line was like, you know, just a typical pop punk, like run of the mill band, which I think I think they did good on with lyrics and definitely, you know, guitar work and stuff like that. But to me, it's like comparing apples and oranges to say we want the Starting Line to sound like Catalyst.
Yeah, it. I think if you took the vocals are super different, obviously, and so I think if like you had Jordan the guy from Newfound Glory, is that his name?
Yeah. Yes,
he could sing on Based on a True Story, and I think Ken could sing on Catalyst, and then it would maybe become clear because their vocals are take it in completely different directions from me. But they're different records, but I think hearing them back to back, I was like, okay, I can definitely see where they maybe even begrudgingly leaned that way.
Yeah. Okay, so when we talked in the DMs at first, I didn't really tell you which album specifically. So you said you were gonna that those were your two albums, Say It Like You Mean It, Based on a True Story, you'd come ready to defend both of them. Now that you've thought about that for a few weeks, listened to the whole discography, put it all in the context, is one better than the other, in your opinion?
I think Say It Like You Mean It. Yeah, Say It Like You Mean It is definitely the shining star of their whole catalog. I think for a while, like when I was 15, 16, 17, Based on a True Story was the one for me because like I said before, Say It Like You Mean It reminds me of being young. And so I think I was like, well, I don't listen to as pop punky music. My tastes are changing or whatever.
Yeah.
But I think Based on a True Story is not quite at the level that I remember. I think it's still very good. And the songs that are good, like Nights and Weekends and Surprise, Surprise is probably my other favorite one off there. That's all still good, but it's not quite as good as I remember it, which then just like, and it does have peaks and valleys in terms of the song engagement ability on Based on a True Story. Whereas Say It Like You Mean It, I think for me personally, the first like 11 songs are very good. And then for me, the last two don't really hit as well.
And just
which is the Drama Memory. Summer.
Okay.
And what's the acoustic one? And then This Ride.
The Drama Summer is just like so juvenile and like I love it though.
It is good, but it's a little too much of that juvenile flavor.
Yeah. It's like you can tell that was like one of the first songs he wrote, I feel like.
Mm-hmm.
About some girl that he probably doesn't even remember at this point.
Karina, I think, if Wikipedia is correct, Karina is the person that all these songs are written about. The Drama Summer, though, is another one that, like, on the live album really shines because of the crowd singing along.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I haven't listened to the live album. That's the one that's like, Somebody's Gonna Miss Us, right? I think that's what it's called. Yeah, I haven't gone back and listened to that one. Would you say it's worth it then? Or I'm not a big live album fan.
They're really good. And I have been thinking this a lot lately that I'm bummed that they're a band that I think must have just never come around when I was into them. Because I do wish I could have seen them live. I saw a number of other bands kind of from that time period that I was into. But it's great. It's really, really good.
Okay.
A live album. Yeah.
Now, okay, so as we kind of sorted through covers from this album, pretty much the only covers we could find were of The Best of Me, which is not shocking. Do you think, I don't want to say, do you think it's earned its popularity? Because I think it has. But do you think there are better songs on this album? Or do you think that is the best song on this album?
I think that if you take that song out of the equation, it's an open field. It's very up for interpretation of like which is the best song. And it's there are different moods for a lot of those songs. I think recently I've been thinking that Almost There, Going Nowhere is maybe my favorite. Aside from Best of Me, and I do think that it's an undeniable hit. I think it is like top 10 pop punk material all time for sure.
I think I agree, but I just think it's just, I think I've heard it too many times to where now it's like, yeah, this is a good song that I'm listening to again. So I think if I could remove like 1,000 of the plays from my memory that I've heard it, then I'd be like, yeah, this is like one of the best pop punk songs of all time. But now I'm just like, I've heard this. So I want to get your opinion on what I would say is my favorite song at this point, because it's a little bit different compared to the rest of the album, but I really like A Good Night's Sleep. What are your thoughts on that one?
Oh, it's so good. That used to be my other favorite. I think that A Good Night's Sleep into Almost There, Going Nowhere, into Cheek to Cheek, I kind of think of those as like a suite, three songs. They just flow really well to me. And so I love that song. I think it's incredible.
Okay.
So good.
I really like the cover they did on
That
Hope Starting Over. It's Nothing's Gonna Stop Us Now, I think the song's called.
They did do that, yeah.
I listened to that today. I had never heard it before.
Yeah, I heard that today too, and like I forgot, like when I first heard it in preparation for this episode a couple of weeks ago, I was like, this is the best song on the EP. Like, why isn't every song like this? And then I looked at like the Wikipedia page and I was like, oh, it's a cover.
Yeah.
That's why the song's so good, because someone else wrote it.
Yeah, they were definitely getting their chops together at that time.
Yeah. Not a bad early EP though.
Yeah, totally. Another one I didn't even realize that they had done the Make Yourself at Home EP. Have you all listened to that?
That's what I was going to ask you about next. Yeah,
it's pretty good. I listened to those songs for the first time today and was pleasantly surprised, especially the first one. I'm pulling it up now. It's just called Make Yourself at Home. Yeah, that's a really good song, and there are some other nice ones on there as well.
Let's check that one out because I don't remember that one. Let's see, Starting Line. While I'm pulling that up, what do you think of the version of Best of Me that's on there?
It's pretty good. You know, he's clearly a very solid singer and is able to pull it off in a live setting. So good on him for sure.
Okay, this is the song Make Yourself at Home from the Make Yourself at Home EP.
Make it a note to take your pills, she said. I'll leave them on the table in the same brown bottle, you know. She said, it's good to have you home. The second that I smelled the scent of my own house, I said it. Send just one postcard home. Call as often as you can to tell us how it goes, let us know.
See, I don't know how I feel about that. I don't, like, it's not bad by any means, but I'm not like, oh, yeah. I think it's just, it's so hard to follow up, say it like you mean it, and for it to be this kind of stripped down EP. I don't know if that was the right choice, maybe.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's their best work, but just going into it, like, having heard plenty of other pop punk acoustic EPs, and they are usually a zero, I was pleasantly surprised. And maybe it's not coming through over the Zoom, but the production value, even though it is stripped down, it does sonically sound pretty cool, especially when you do with the acoustics. So for being stripped down, I thought it was pretty good.
So speaking of Sticks and Stones, this song that we just listened to has that kind of weird electronic drum beat at the beginning. And there's a song on Sticks and Stones that starts off with that I hated at the time, but really like now. So and for this EP to start with that, I remember just hearing that going like what the fuck is this? And then probably just not even listening to the rest of the EP for, you know, months or years later. And it's definitely better than I remember at the time, but I don't know, something about my, you know, 15-year-old brain or whatever did not like those electronic drum thing. Yeah.
I think that is singled out, the song that we were talking about earlier.
Is it?
Yeah.
I think
that's not a good one. Yeah.
It, and I think at the time, and I grew up playing drums too, and so anything, especially at that age, I was obsessed with Travis Barker. So anything that wasn't like really big and crazy, I thought was lame. And so I probably did think that it was dinky, but now I am pretty okay with it. And
yeah, it's fine.
I make music that sounds like that, so it's chill.
Okay. All right. I mean, I don't think I've got anything else on the starting line. Is there anything else that you wanted to add, or?
I mean, I felt that you probably had some reverence and appreciation of direction, so I didn't want to tear it up too bad.
Feel free. I can't be offended. It's not like I wrote it or something.
And I mean, that's kind
welcome
of the thing.
Controversy on this podcast.
Yeah.
I think after the for me personally, and I think that there are plenty of people who probably defend it. It's probably a lot of people's favorite album. For me personally, and for my wife, who I subjected it to last night.
Okay.
She was mad at me that I had made her listen to it after we're done. Because I just think that there's even songs about it, right? Like Way with Words, You've Lost Your Way with Words, and like these songs about how you're like, am I not good at writing songs anymore? Do I not have interesting ideas? And Somebody's Gonna Miss Us is like, we're probably not gonna be a band for very much longer. Hopefully somebody gives a shit. And so, like, I get the vibe that maybe he was having a tough time writing songs, and sometimes that comes across in a like compelling way. But it kind of just bummed me out. Like, I could feel the his personal maybe struggling with not feeling the songs as much anymore. That's my take on it.
It like feels like he was like sort of stuck with being in the starting line but wanting to like move on, because like, have you heard Person L? His like,
no, I just saw that on Wikipedia today, so I'm probably,
yeah, they were a lot heavier and like sort almost like a post-hardcore band, yeah, like kind of type thing. But super, he's like he's super talented on those records.
He's great, like, at singing. He's really
amazing.
Good.
He's a great singer. He's a really good bass player too, if you like, if you pay close enough attention.
On the live ones, he even adds some stuff in there where it's really like, whoa, tasty licks.
Yeah.
I think with his voice too, and I'm like an electronic music person, and so I always want to go there, but I think like he could even lend his vocal talents to some, you know, more modern type stylings, and it would come across really well. That would be cool, I think.
For sure, yeah. Okay, so you mentioned Somebody's Gonna Miss Us. I've got two questions on that song that I want your opinion on. One, what do you think, and you may, depending on how far back your pop music knowledge goes or familiarity, one, what did you make of the Ace of Base reference?
I couldn't remember what the song was, but obviously I know it. What is the line that he says there? He's like,
all that you want is another baby.
Oh yeah, because he's saying like, if you want to listen to some other songs, go listen to some other songs, might I suggest, or something like that, right?
Yeah, he says, if you can't relate and refuse to sing along, then maybe I can interest you in some other song, a little something like All That She Wants Is Another Baby. And then he sings like the exact melody from that Ace of Base song from like 1992 or something.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
It was cool, but also it felt very like viscerally bitter to me. Like,
yeah.
Like he is pissed off about people not like, you know, giving his band enough credit, I guess, or something like that anymore. Like, cause I think the pop punk wave it kind of crested by that point, and
yeah,
it was like heading towards the indie wave sort of at that time in 2007, and sort of the zeitgeist, I feel like, and which maybe is also why I didn't like that record as much, because I was kind of turning in that same sort of more hipstery Pitchfork direction of that era,
yeah,
like Animal Collective and Dan Deacon or that sort of thing.
Okay.
Or and like then, even Death Cab or Modest Mouse or something like
okay.
that.
Okay. And then in that same song, I don't know if you caught it, but did you catch the reference to Say It Like You Mean It? And two, what do you make of that?
Please fill me in. I must have missed it.
Okay, so the song starts with the lyrics, "If this is worth my time, then I'll be here for a while. If this is worth your while, then you're making me smile." And then he says, "If S-I-L-Y-M is all you want, then I'm not sure how much in common we've got." And that would be obviously the abbreviation or the initials for Say It Like You Mean It.
Yeah. Also bums me out. I don't know. I mean, it must suck to, you know, feel boxed in, right? And feel like you need to repackage the same shit over and over again.
Yeah. Not if you're Newfound Glory.
Yeah, I've been doing that
for like 25 years almost.
And I same thing. After Catalyst, I enjoyed Sticks and Stones and Catalyst, but that's all the Newfound Glory I've ever listened to. I did not keep up.
You should definitely go back and listen to Not Without a Fight, the one that Mark Hoppus produced. It's phenomenal. I think like really nice. Good.
It's pretty good. It's like it's one of their heavier albums where like they're super trying to do the easy core thing.
And so man, it is a swing and a miss sometimes for bands to like, we're gonna be harder now. This is our harder record. It sometimes does not land.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, well, that's like the that's like the follow up to their like softest album, Coming Home, where they trying to be like damn near adult contemporary.
Well, and they got run through the
yeah, they don't play
basically for that like.
Yeah.
Everyone hated that album, which I don't get. I thought it was good as well. Like I love everything Newfound Glory did up until Radio Surgery, which was the one after Not Without a Fight, and then that's when they just kind of
that one sucks.
I'm looking forward to the Newfound Glory episode for sure.
I'll have a lot to say on that one.
I don't know if either of you were into this band, but speaking of records that Mark Hoppus produced, Commit This to Memory by Motion City Soundtrack is another huge record for me. Alex looks like he doesn't care for it at all.
No, this is I love Motion City Soundtrack. I would call them like one of the most important bands for me, let's say high school, post-high school till now. But for me, it's My Dinosaur Life, Even If It Kills Me, and Go. I never really got into Commit This to Memory, and I've gotten a lot more into it again in recent
years.
None of
the early stuff. Wow.
I think Hangman with Mark Hoppus is great. I think there's some other really good ones in there, but that
great
one,
song.
Yeah, I just never really got that one. For me, it's My Dinosaur Life is the big one.
That was a really, really good one. Yeah, for sure.
I haven't listened. I had Even If It Kills Me, and I thought that it was kind of like a better version of the same symptoms that Direction has, where like he's not having as good of songwriting ideas, but it was still good. Like I like Even If It Kills Me a lot. I think my taste had changed too. So
that felt like their more mature record. Mm-hmm. Even If It Kills Me.
Yeah,
it was the one right after Commit This to Memory. I mean, which Commit This to Memory was admittedly huge. So I think it was hard for them to follow up on it, but I think they did it really well. So are you saying
they're great songs? Awesome songs on there.
So did you ever listen to My Dinosaur Life? I feel like you were about to tell me you never did.
No, I've never heard that. I've never heard Go. Is there one after that too?
Yeah, Panic Stations, but that one's not as good.
Okay, yeah.
I've never heard those two. Go.
Yeah, I have not listened to those, but I love I Am the Movie too.
Stuff is so good. Those first two albums are amazing.
And I Am
and
the
to
Movie.
To call back to the Hello Goodbye episode, I do think that Motion City was doing it before Hello Goodbye was, if I believe
so too, based on some the Lost interview, we kind of unearthed that.
Oh,
But and I Am the Movie is another one. I don't think I've listened to it enough to give a good opinion on it. I love The Future Freaks Me Out. That was my number one song on Spotify this year. Now that's because of my son. He's obsessed with it, but it is a great song. So I mean, I don't feel bad about that being my number one song for the year.
No, it's great. And the other single off that. my favorite accident was how I
got it. Oh, that is a really good one.
Yeah, great video. And then, yeah, I saw the video and wanted to get into the band too. So,
okay. Well, I mean, is there anything else you want to talk about? Like, we can talk about whatever. If there's something you want to rant about.
We can stay in the drive-through realm. And okay. If you guys want to edit this down, if some of it's good and some of it's not, or none of it's good.
Could you take another bite of the McRib first?
Yeah, I can. Okay.
I think we need a McRib break.
I was expecting. I didn't taste any pickles the first bite, so I'm gonna.
That's fine. Like, fuck the pickles. Don't worry about the pickles. I got mine with no pickles.
The pickles are definitely McDonald's pickles.
Yeah, that's the problem. Yeah.
Are you getting the chewing on the mic?
I'm getting a little bit of it. I mean, maybe if you could send me the stems of just the chewing, I can just drop those in.
And that'll be the whole interview.
Yeah, we're actually going to edit everything other than the chewing of the pickles. Okay, so you were going to say something.
A big fan of the bread. Sorry.
No, yeah, the bread's not great. So I don't know if you saw my tweet today, but I've done like a ton of research on the McRib, and they said it's actually cheaper to make it in a circle and just use their normal hamburger buns, but they like the novelty of the fact that it looks like a rack of ribs or whatever.
It would be much better on their bun for sure.
Yeah, I think so.
It's not bad though. Not bad at all. I'm definitely going to finish it.
And you have to go to McRibLocator.com and report your sighting.
That's right.
If you don't do that, then you're just a poser.
It's like you encountered it in the wild, like a Pokemon or something.
Right, exactly.
A wild McRib appeared. I'll just touch on the couple other drive-through things that I like came into contact with. I did really like Hello Goodbye at the time. I saw them open for Motion City.
Oh,
it was
nice.
Really good. Stray Light Run played as well, and I almost fell asleep during their set.
Okay. Stray Light Run or Hello Goodbye?
Stray Light Run.
Okay.
Hello Goodbye. They should have put Stray Light Run first, because like Hello Goodbye was huge energy, so much fun. Stray Light Run was a nap, and then you had to get gear up for Motion City, which was great.
I bet. Oh God, I still haven't seen them live. I hate it.
They were great, and I saw Pierre's other band when I was living in Minneapolis too.
Oh, okay. Does it have the word
F?
Is it the one that's like kind of like a super group thing, or?
It might be. It's a little bit darker subject matter and stuff. It was good, you know, but I never got into it.
Okay.
Band. And then the only other I just saw today that Through put out the Senses Fail EP, the first EP.
They did. Mm-hmm.
From Autumn to Ashes, I think it's called.
No, it's From the Depths of Dreams.
From Depths of Dreams. That's right. And I don't really think it holds up. I think it's produced very poorly.
I never liked it in the first place.
I
never got into that band at all.
I don't think I would have, but the very first show I ever went to was Senses Fail opening up for the canceled pop punk band, the very big one. It rhymes with Bland Crew. Senses Fail, I think, was like the breakout star that night. Like, it was crazy. I was 12 years old, super sweaty, the guy's like hanging from the rafters and doing his thing, and so I bought the EP and really loved it at the time, but it's not very good now looking
I
back
agree
but for a 12 year old, spot on.
All right, before we wrap up, in preparation for this interview, I just kind of tried to figure out more about you. We've interacted a lot on Twitter, but I don't really know a lot about you. I stumbled onto your Spotify page. So do you have music that you want to plug or anything else you want to plug before we wrap this up?
Yeah, I make music under the name Makebelief. It's all one word. It's at Makebelief Music for all the Instagram, SoundCloud, Twitter. Instagram and Twitter are probably my two biggest ones. And then we're just coming up on the year anniversary of the debut album that I put out, which is called Confusion Fruit. It is on Spotify. On January 17th, we're doing a pretty cool thing that I was supposed to tour on it last year, and then COVID obviously happened. And so we had a plan that was going to be my wife and I, she's kind of does the art direction stuff for me.
Okay.
And so on January 17th for the year anniversary, we're going to be doing something very cool. So keep your eyes on that. And then if you're a fan of the podcast that maybe was the ancestor to this podcast, the Blink 155 formerly, I did make 3 hour long compilations of the best covers, best Blink 182 covers in the world. You can find them through the links in my bios and stuff. And I think Blink 155 or 155 now did an Instagram post about it as well. But
awesome.
If you liked that podcast and you are like, man, I heard some crazy version of this song on one of these episodes, but I can't remember, it's probably on there. It's like 300 songs or something like that. So check those out.
Well, very cool. So with Makebelief, is it, I know you said your wife does some of the art direction, but with the musical stuff, is it all just you then?
Yep. It's just me and my computer and some drums and lots of gizmos and auto tune vocals, but in a kind of a more experimental sound collage sort of way. And yeah, give it a whirl. The stuff that I'm working on right now has been all since I've started listening to Blink 155 and sort of re-embracing those parts of my roots, the pop punk stuff. And so it's not that kind of music, but I'm allowing for that influence to be a part of my life again. So yeah, hopefully it's to the liking of people who like that kind of stuff.
And are you hoping, like, once, you know, we have the vaccine and some of this shit's behind us to tour on it, or is that still a plan in the future? Okay, cool.
Yeah, absolutely. I love playing live, and the old music is nice and I like it and I want people to hear it, but I'm really excited about the new stuff. So I've never played any of it live before, so that'll be really fun for people to see.
Come through Wisconsin, man. I'll book you a show.
You know I will. That's a hop, skip, and a jump away from me. So.
Yes, it is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. And if you come to Salt Lake City, we'll have to, yeah, for sure. We'll have to get together and I don't know.
Oh, yeah. there's some other Salt Lake Nation people, too, that I have also.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a few of us. Link up, so. All right, well, Skylar, thank you so much for coming. We appreciate it. And
yeah, dude, thanks.
I like the show a lot. I'm very excited to learn more about these bands and to see where you guys go. Can't wait to see what the next collection is going to be. Like, it's super
cool.
It's
going to be good. We already got an idea.
You already know what it's going to be?
Yeah.
Is it 10 episodes per thing? Is that what you're doing?
I think there's not like a set number because this one keeps growing. I think at this point, the drive-thru one's going to be close to 14 episodes. So
cool. Yeah. Super cool.
Well, but yeah, we'd love to have you back on sometime, maybe again on this collection, maybe on another one.
Yeah, just let me know. I love it. And yeah, thank you so much for having me. This has been a blast.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Oh, yeah, dude.